The MotoGP paddock has arrived in Jerez for the first European Grand Prix of the season. But before we head to the track, we've taken a small detour. Now, we know the MotoGP riders live for a challenge. So when Yak Mountain invited us down to tackle their climbing wall, one rider in particular stood out as the man for the job.
Hi, Amy.
Hello. How are you? How are you?
Good, and you?
Not too bad.
What do you prepare for me?
Have you figured it out yet?
Climbing? Never did before.
We'll be all right, I promise.
One, two, let's go. Not so much.
So Aleix, the reason why I thought you'd be the perfect man for the job here at Yak Mountain was because you're no stranger to taking on new challenges. This has been a really big year for you, joining forces with Suzuki for them to re-enter the championship. How's the experience been? Has it been harder than you expected or easier?
I mean, we are still not in the front, so not easy. But the way I arrived at the team was easy. The team, I really love the team. The way we are working is fantastic. It's 10 times more professional than last year. So it's very good. The atmosphere in the team is fantastic because, you know, the factory teams are really big. But with Suzuki, I felt that we are like a small family. It's not easy to feel this with just 3 months. And I already have this feeling, so this is fantastic. But obviously, we are here to stay in the front, and we are working for it.
Funny you mentioned that, because every time I speak to you after the race, the results have been pretty decent, considering it's only the first three races of this season. But you haven't seemed happy with them. Like,
I mean, obviously, if they told us, for example, in Valencia test after the last race, that we were battling for the top eight at the first races, we had one first line, maybe we sign in that moment. But if I join Suzuki, a big brand, factory team, is to stay in the podium. And obviously we are a little bit far for the moment. I know I have to be patient. I know that the bike needs to improve. I need to also to understand a little bit more my team and my bike. But I will be happy when we are in the podium.
It's the first European Grand Prix of this year. How are you feeling about the GSXRR tackling Jerez?
Good. Good, because Jerez is one track that the layout I like a lot. Also, there is not a big straight. It's really technical track, and our bike is really good in the tight tracks where you need to turn a lot. So I think Jerez can be a good track. Last year was not bad for me. I finished, I think, sixth, and I started in the grid in fifth position. So yeah, I think we can do a good job, and I hope we can stay more close to the podium than in Argentina in Austin.
Coming into round four, you and your brother are lining up 8th and 9th in the championship standings, respectively. It's his second year in the MotoGP class this year. What approach are you taking with him this year? Are you kind of leaning back and go, hey, it's you on your own this year? Do you see him more as a rival this year?
Yeah, for sure. Also, last year was a big rival. We were fighting for the top, for the sixth place all season. Finally, he beat me. This year, Paul have more experience. His Yamaha is really close from Vale and Jorge's bike. So he was not really lucky at the first part of the season. He was not really, really quick. And also Scott hit him in Austin, so he lost a lot of points. But I think Paul going to improve a lot. It's going to be very difficult to beat him, because with 1 year experience, really good bike, he will be really close from the podium. But my objective, as I said at the beginning, is try to beat the Tech 3 Yamahas, Carl's Hondas, and try to be really close from Ducatis. And obviously, Paul and Smith and Carl, for me, these three riders are our big opponents.
So,
Fans questions. Easy.
We've taken to Twitter, and I will start with a question from at Tommy Addis. Hopefully I've said it right. And he's asked you, or she's asked you, what inspired you to become a professional MotoGP racer?
What you need to be a professional, you mean?
Or what inspired you? What made you want to be a rider?
Why?
Yeah.
I mean, when you start when you're young, it's just like a game. You go like, for example, your friends in during the weekend, they play football, they play basket, and I go to play with my motorbike. And year by year, you are growing, and every day is more professional. And when you're around 14, 15 years old, you see that it's kind of job. And obviously right now, I don't know what I can do if I'm not a rider. It's my passion, it's my life, and I love it.
The second question comes from at Nicholas Stevens, and she asked, what is your most important pre-race ritual?
I don't have big rituals, but for example, when I walk from my seat to my bike, I always touch my head.
You do?
Yes, always I touch my head, and it's like, I don't know, just maybe to activate me.
I know I've spoken to other riders and they like make sure they put the left boot on first, yeah, and then the right, yeah, boot on.
For example, I just touch my head.
It's quite a good one. And the final one comes from Espargaro, and he or she asks, what's your prediction for Wednesday's FC Barcelona again or the BOMI?
This is a good one. I hope we're going to win. I will be in the stadium, yeah, and with my brother, and it's going to be interesting, really fun game, and I hope we can win and we can enjoy.
Fingers crossed.
Maybe 2-0.
2-0? Fingers crossed. Thanks, Aleix.
Right,
so we've now, unfortunately, as much as it'd be really nice to stay here and have another go at the climb, we need to head back to the track.
Yeah, we have to work.
It's time to start working. Let's go.
Let's go.
Well, before moving on to the races, we thought we'd mark the occasion of the first European Grand Prix to show you what a full fat paddock really looks like. As you can see behind us, we've got all the trucks, the hospitalities back, the equipment stalls and the motorhomes, because before this, we travelled about 30,000 kilometres just to get to Jerez, which meant the paddock was a little bit travel size. Well, now that's not the case, and we thought we'd show you a little bit what it's all about. So let's head on a little walkabout. For starters, the motorhome. Most MotoGP riders live in either a rented or their own motorhome at the track. It's of course very important to have these home comforts. They have a lot more media commitments, a lot more fans around here, so it's very, very important that they have this kind of sanctuary so close to the box. But rather than heading straight to the box, you can come to your hospitality. Now, regardless of whether you're a rider, thank you very much, whether you're a rider, a team manager, or team staff, PR, whoever, you can come here for breakfast, you can have lunch, dinner, you can watch the sessions on the screen when there actually are some sessions, or you can just have a coffee. But let's say you're one of the riders or one of the rider's personal assistants and the session is about to get underway. Now the bike might be ready in the box, but you yourself need to be equipped as well. Then you might come here to Alpine Stars just to double check that your leathers are absolutely fine. You might need a few last minute adjustments. You might even want to try a different pair of sliders depending on the conditions. But basically, whatever it is you need, this is the place to come. Now, we change profession and imagine you're a mechanic. Now, you've come here, you've got your tyre rack, you've got your list of tyres you need for either today or for the whole weekend. Where do you come? Of course, you come to Bridgestone, where you'll see the guys mounting the tyres, getting them balanced, and of course, getting them all to the right pressure for the weekend. Yet there are a few more stops we have to do before getting to the box. The trucks. Now, most teams will have two, a bit like with the Monster Yamaha Tech 3 team. Now, they'll both be used to transport the bikes, the equipment, and the tools. However, there'll always be one that's more like a designated office. Well, this one, as you can see, is the kind of office space which could be used as a bit of a sanctuary for the riders between sessions, used by team managers for debriefs, maybe even with the crew chiefs as well, or sometimes even for the PR side of things with Milena here with the Tech 3 team. Now, we don't have Herve, the team manager, around to tell us, but what's the goal for this weekend, Milena?
Win, as always.
Simple and to the point. Right, and now on to truck number two, or number one, whichever way you look at it, which is the mechanic sanctuary. Well, it might not look like very much, but it's a very important place here with Fabien, our parts manager. He's looking after all these little bits which you need in the back of the truck, maybe not enough space in the box. For instance, we have a few brake discs lying around here. You can have many, many different little parts of the bike. There's just not quite enough room in the box. But of course, there might be a few other jobs as well, a few other parts which you may not want lying around there. For instance, if you've had a little bit of a spill, maybe a little bit of crash damage like we see with the fairing here. So that's why we have this extra mechanical truck behind the box. But now let's go to the actual box, the mechanical hub of the team. So we've almost come to the end of our tour now, and regardless of whether you're a rider, a mechanic, a team manager, you should be fed, have all your personal equipment, have the right tyres, and of course the right frame of mind, because once you come here, once you end up in the box, that's when things really count.
Come on, we're ready.
Now, if they really were ready, we're going to find out very shortly as we head up pit lane to meet up with our guest who's going to talk us through the MotoGP race. So in the meantime, we're going to leave you with highlights from Moto3 and Moto2.
23 laps of the Jerez circuit. Moto3 sets us off here in Spain.
Brilliant start from pole position from Fabio Quartararo. Oliveira got away well, the number 44, as did Philipp Ertl. It's going to be Oliveira, though, up the inside of Quartararo to lead at the first corner.
Real unlucky for the Czech rider. He was in that great fight for fifth place with Efren Vasquez.
Oliveira takes the lead at turn one.
Final lap underway, Oliveira in the lead.
Here comes Kent. Quartararo, I don't know if he can do anything about it. Oliveira runs it wide and Kent retakes the lead.
Oliveira did run it wide, but he's got the inside line at turn seven and moves back underneath. Quartararo right on the inside, line up the inside, Quartararo in way too hot, almost touched with Danny Kent. Danny Kent almost had a big mistake, but Kent is going to win this race from Oliveira, surely.
Danny Kent, three successive Grand Prix victories for the British rider. In second place, Miguel Oliveira, third Brad Binder, and a mistake by Quartararo puts him down in fourth place. Round four of the Moto2 World Championship.
Superb start from pole position by the world champion Tito Rabat. He surely is going to lead the way in the run-up to the first corner.
Here comes Rins up into third place. There's nothing Luthi can do about it, but it was mighty close, but he holds the advantage.
There he is, Tito Rabat, with Jonas Folger for close company. Oh, contact there. Well, Rabat looked like he might have actually run wide coming out of turn five. Coming under attack again from Zarco at the first corner. Zarco has the inside line.
Folger is going to win the race, and that there is no doubt. Here comes Rins. He's come
out. Rins
has gone. He's hit the back wheel. Rins has gone down. He has crashed out of the race, and Folger wins here in the red.
Jonas Folger over the line to take a majestic victory here in the Spanish Grand Prix.
Zarco
took second place. The contact from Rins must have had an impact on Rabat. Well, there is Rins, fairing, flapping off that Kalex bike. He crosses the line in 18th place.
Well, certainly some excitement there in the final corner for the support classes. But now let's move on to MotoGP. And our guest for today is Francesco Guidotti, team manager of Pramac Racing. Francesco.
Hi.
Hi. Thank you very much for joining us.
Well,
actually,
pleasure.
Letting us be in your garage for this. Now, this race, a bit of a different one. We've had a lot of exciting races, lots of touches so far. This one was a bit more of a procession, one could say. I mean, what was your opinion?
Yeah, it's the fault of Lorenzo. It's Lorenzo's fault because he started on Friday morning in FP1 to make his pace, and his pace was really fast. Nobody was able to follow him. So we understood since the first practice that it could be Lorenzo's race again.
Okay, well, Lorenzo's race. Let's take a look at what Lorenzo's race was exactly. Remind ourselves of the highlights, and then we'll come back to you in a minute.
It's great to be back in Europe. Great to be at Jerez, round four of the championship.
Lorenzo made a really good start from pole position. He had a glance to his right to see where Marc Marquez was. Paul Espargaro got away exceptionally well too. It's Marquez behind Jorge Lorenzo. Espargaro in third.
This is Andrea Dovizioso. This is down on the brakes at the final corner. You can clearly see he's going to run off. He made a mistake earlier on that lap at turn six.
Here comes Rossi. Rossi up into third place, past Paul Espargaro.
Kutslow having another look now at turn nine while they're having this battle. Well, Paul Espargaro there runs wide on the brakes going into turn nine. No second invitation needed for Cal Crutchlow. It's been a masterclass from Jorge Lorenzo. Well, there he goes, a victory salute to his fans there. Brilliant from Lorenzo.
Lorenzo wins the 55th Grand Prix of his career as he wins here in Jerez. Marc Marquez crosses the line in second place. What a brave ride by him. And Valentino Rossi, his 200th podium finish.
We have another contender in there now as we make our way to Le Mans.
For the first time since 2011, Jorge Lorenzo has reclaimed Jerez as Lorenzo's land.
Well, Francesco was absolutely right. It was Jorge Lorenzo dominating. Francesco, when you see that as a team manager, a rider being so, so dominant and just putting in these laps with such precision, he looks so smooth, but he almost looks slow at times. How impressed are you with that?
A lot, for sure. It's impressive, but we know Lorenzo's riding style. We know Lorenzo's attitude on this kind of performance. So. Yeah, it's always a surprise, but it's a nice surprise for the fans, for the real fans of motorcycle in general, because Lorenzo's style of ride is really amazing.
Okay, well, now we're going to move on to Marc Marquez. Now, you guys will probably know Marc Marquez had this little finger in his left hand broken, but he actually told us after the race that the problem was his right arm. Marc was trying to compensate very much with his finger, and he had problems there. But even so, this Rossi was catching up with him. It was almost down to a second. The team told him, and he went for it. What were you thinking at the time?
It's another amazing rider, for sure. And it's an opposite style of riding compared to Lorenzo. But Lorenzo and Marc was the only two riders able to run under the 39. So, yeah, it's a surprise because we know the injury and we know the difficulty to ride for 27 laps in this weather condition, very hot, very warm. And Rossi was catching him again, and the pressure for sure was high. But yeah, Marc is get used us to control this. I mean, what happened in Argentina was a surprise, and now he come back.
Okay. Now I want to move on to your riders. Now, if you guys haven't seen it, we're just going to show you this high-speed shot of Yoni Hernandez and Danilo Petrucci in the last turn. Now, it wasn't the final turn, it wasn't the final lap, but there was a little bit of contact there. I think your riders gave you a few nerves. Maybe you didn't see everything on camera, but on the timing screens, they were this close together. I mean, it surely must be great seeing your riders close together, but the overall performance where they finished, what did you make of that?
I mean, yeah, we control it from the videos, I mean, from the time schedule. And we know, we've seen that they were very, very close, and I was a bit scared.
A little bit of contact because we see we have Yoni's brake guard missing, maybe a little bit of damage when that happened.
Yeah, I don't know. They told us that they have a nice fight, a very close fight between themselves and also with Vinales. So I don't know what happened exactly, at the end of the race, everybody was pretty happy about the result. Of course, Danilo a bit less than Jonny, but overall, I think they had a very good race.
Okay, well, Francesco, thank you very much for your time on this. Very interesting to get your insights. And now we're going to leave you guys with a few more images of a Jorge Lorenzo MotoGP masterclass.
Lorenzo wins the 55th Grand Prix of his career as he wins here in Jerez.
Going in the lane.
No,
please, all right. No, no.
Oh, I love it. Great wind up there from Lorenzo.